reality, circularity, and competitiveness via the Process for a Planet Strategic Research and Innovation Agenda. He is strongly involved in the setup of the bio-based economy in Flanders and Europe, and the collaboration between Europe and India on bioeconomy and water business. He is a founding father and now chairman of the advisory board of the Shared Research Center of Bioaromatics. He's also the father of Bioinnovation for Growth Cluster of the Trilateral Alliance between Flanders, the Netherlands, and North Rhine. Westphalia and the Vanguard Initiative on Interregional Smart Specialization on Bioaromatics. He's also working on the combination of bioeconomy and circular economy with a strong emphasis on the use of wood and wood residues for integrated applications in many sectors, with a first focus on construction material. I am very excited for this conversation. I think it'll be a very, very interesting topic. And with this, I would like to hand it over to Dr. Ash for the first question.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. And once again, a warm welcome. Professor Ludo, we're so honored to have you here. And we're really looking forward to this conversation. I'd like to start us off, sir, if you wouldn't mind, with your perspective on leadership within this field. What would leadership mean to you, sir? And you know, what would the implications be for young people in particular? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ash, for the nice introduction, and also Anna for the introduction. Also, I would like to say that it's really for me a big honor to do this in a tribute to Dr. Achenda Pachauri, who was really a very good friend of mine. And so I'm really happy to join today and to do this in this discussion. Indeed, leadership is becoming extremely important. And I think the world needs what I call a transition to a new vision. So it's not just a change, or it is not just an improvement. It's a transition. It means we have to go to something which is completely different. And what it means, that is this future vision. And I believe that there is not one vision, or there is no right or wrong vision. So we all together have to work to look to our dreams and to see what kind of vision will be possible to create a sustainable world. And in that way, it's extremely important to inspire and facilitate all people around us, especially, of course, the youth people, because they will make the change. They will live in this, what I call the decade of action. So it's extremely important to do this. And what is important for an old person as me is to give some direction and to indicate what are potential pathways to go to that vision. It's not at all my job to say, this is the way you have to go. No, it's we see different possibilities, and we must do a lot of different tests, pilots, to go to a new vision of the world. And this is really everything. Another point, which is extremely important, is what I call knitting. So the connection of the different issues to it together. And this is sometimes extremely difficult. We already had, before we started a discussion about biodiversity, a lot of people are seeing climate issues already quite nicely. They see that there is a problem, but if you then speak about biodiversity, they think, oh, it's not so important. But at the same time, we have to think about poverty reduction, etc. All these things must be linked to each other. We cannot solve the climate issues if we are not solving in the same time biodiversity issues, etc. So that is what I call knitting. So intertwingle everything. And this is, of course, not easy and cannot be done by one person. So that's why we need huge communities to think about all these links, etc., and to see how we can move forward. Concerning the vision, I also think that different people will have different feelings, different perceptions of what the future can be. But this is not a problem. We do not want, per definition, to go to one defined future vision. It can all depend on a lot of different situations. So we do not want to go to a one uniform world, but we must move to a sustainable, diversified world. So it means there are, of course, boundary conditions created by our planet, and we are passing these boundary conditions now, so we have to come back to this, so to find new equilibria. I also think that we cannot just say we have to go to the equilibrium of the past, because we changed so much that this is not possible. Also, in the past, we had maybe 1 billion people living on our planet. Now we are moving to 8-9 billion. So it is not possible to have the same equilibrium, but we have to reach an equilibrium. And what it means is, again, this general vision. And in that way, I think we have to take into account all the issues on technology to help us, all the issues, and that's linked to technology, on energy, biodiversity, but then also all the different ecological and societal issues. We cannot move to a sustainable world where a few billion people are living in poverty. We can also not move to a world where 8 billion people is living in a system where we are using all the resources in an extremely fast or short period of time. So that's also not possible. So we have to think how we can do this. And so in that way, all kinds of small or big experiments somewhere in the world done by some young people are extremely important. Finally, I would like to say here that this change, this new vision, must be attractive. And I will explain it. So in a lot of cases, people say, you will not be allowed anymore to travel. You are not allowed to drive a car. You are not allowed to do this and to do that. Of course, it's true in a certain way, but by giving this message, I think we will not be successful, because people will not like to hear such a message. The same that we have seen with the COVID crisis, when it was forbidden to meet, etc. A lot of people were reacting against it. So if we have to create a situation that becomes attractive. And that's also something we have seen with COVID. If you don't have to drive to your work every day, because you can do it from your home, you have much more time to spend with your children, to spend to do some sport, etc. So we have to look to these positive issues. And it's very difficult, because we are so conservative in our way of thinking that we don't want to see it. But I think leadership means that we create a breakthrough here, and that we really show what is possible and how a new world can look like without complaining that we are moving to a bad situation, etc. We are moving to a very great situation, of which a lot more people can make use of it, etc. But we have to be creative, and being creative, I think that's exactly something that young people can do very well. And so let's be critical to each other, but in a positive way, and try to understand how we can move on to such a sustainable world.
Thank you so much, sir. And I'd like to say, Dad had the greatest love and respect for you. And it's of profound meaning to us to have your support and your guidance as we proceed to to fulfill his vision and legacy. So thank you so much for this great opportunity and also for your amazing perspective on the importance of coming together, the role of young people being constructive and being creative in the process of finding solutions, which no doubt we need to do. And like you said, the past has been left behind, but we need to learn the lessons we need to learn and move ahead. And we need to move ahead with a renewed vision and a renewed energy, which certainly the youth of the world offer. Having said that, we need to come together in order to be able to make it happen. So the collectivization in this process and the exchange at many generations and levels is crucial in order for us to be able to achieve this. And I deeply appreciate your setting the context for us to start thinking about what leadership means and what we need to do today more than ever. Especially in terms of preserving our biodiversity, loving and respecting the different forms of life we are so blessed to share this planet with. So I want to thank you very much for your absolutely invaluable perspective. And with that, I'm going to request Anna to take us through the rest of the conversation. And many thanks once again.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ash and Professor Diels, for that amazing answer. I really like everything you said. And I would now like to hand it over to our first question from our youth leader, Vanshika. So Vanshika, you may ask your question.
Thank you. So my question was that now, today, in lots of parts of the world, we're all becoming extremely stressed because of climate change and how water is running out. And in some countries, it has already run out. So how can we effectively communicate the importance of reducing the stress for our survival? And how can citizens of countries that are likely to run out of water convey to the government into taking action?
Thanks, Vanshika, for this extremely important question indeed. The problem is that fresh water sources are not endless. And until a while, we thought that we need water and we go where we can find it. There is always somewhere a fresh water source. It can be a river, but it can be a river hundreds of kilometers away where we take fresh water. It can be groundwater, or it can even be seawater. That was the way of thinking. And what we have done in the meantime was that we contaminated so much our rivers that this is not a good source anymore as or feedstock for water production. We are extracting so much groundwater that we are going more and more downwards and that we are depleting our groundwater sources. Even we are coming in salty groundwater aquifers, etc. So this creates a lot of problems. So then finally we thought, okay, we go to the sea and we start the desalination. And then, of course, this is only a technology that can be afforded by countries that do have cheap energy. And this cheap energy means fossil energy and so on. So this is also a little bit tricky. So this is as a kind of introduction to your question. So we cannot rely on fresh water. There has been a time that that even canals and tubes, pipelines were made for hundreds of kilometers to get from a fresh water source somewhere. Then it was used and immediately contaminated and going to the sea. So this is not possible. So in fact, on our planet, we have a certain amount of water, which is not changing. So, but of available water for everybody, that's another issue. And so we have to take care of that. And the availability of water depends strongly on the way we use it and we reuse it. This is the only way that is possible, that is that we take from what nature or what the planet gives us, a very small part of the water, and we use it in a circular system. And it can be also a combination. It can be that we use it first as drinking water, then it is sewage water that is treated, and that is then used by the industry, and so on, or it can be used afterwards for irrigation in agriculture, so that we try to make it more and more circular, or even fully circular, that we continuously use the same amount of water. Having said that, I think people will say, and if you want to communicate it to the authorities, they will say, yeah, but it's costly and we do not have the money, etc. Then I think that we have to look to two issues. First of all, everybody has a right to have access to clean water. That's the first point. But nobody has the right to just spill the water wherever he wants. So we have the right to have access to water, but we must use it in a sustainable way. So that's the first condition. And second, I think we have to take into account the fact that if we look, for instance, to wastewater, there are other issues than just the water. Wastewater contains components. This can be salts. Salts can be recovered and have a value. This can be some chemical products. They have a value. This can be fibers. It's already happening in Europe that we extract the fibers from the wastewater and use it again. And on top, and that's extremely important, contaminated water has a certain amount of organic carbon. We call it COD or BOD. And this organic carbon, in fact, has an energy content. And there are two ways to look at it. Either we want to destroy it completely, so it means we oxidize it, and that's what is happening in a classical wastewater treatment plant, where we put an aeration on it, and then we make CO2 into the air. The other way that we can do is to do it in an anaerobic way, and then we produce biogas that we can use as an energy source. So this is much more sustainable. So I think we have to strongly to discuss about this new approach of not putting energy in the water, but taking energy out of the water. And this is also linked not only to water and energy, but also to water and waste. We have a lot of waste that contains a lot of energy, where again, we can make this, this combination. And finally, I think we have to see the water climate biodiversity nexus, where all these things again can be integrated. And I would like to give you one example, which is an example of India in the region of Jamnagar, where the wastewater of oil refinery plant was treated, and this treated water was used for the irrigation of some forests. So by making use of, this was seawater that was desalinated, because that region is nearly a desert, the water was used in the factory, then treated, then used to irrigate forest, and in that way we create a lot of biomass that we can use again. It was also used to cultivate mango fruit, etc. And on top, and that's extremely important, the temperature there decreased by 2 degrees. So by doing this kind of integration, you have a lot of benefits. You have no harm to the ecology, to nature, but on top, you create a benefit for the climate. You create an economic benefit because you produce fruit or you produce wood that you can sell, etc. So we have to combine all these issues so that water is getting a feedstock, which creates a lot of economic benefits to a lot of different stakeholders. And I think that's also a kind of message we have to give to our authorities, that it's not just an issue that costs you money. It can also provide you a lot of jobs. It can create a lot of opportunities, and it can create a lot of financial benefits as well, if we integrate it in the right way. And so in the past, we looked to water as something that is given by nature, and we took it. Then we started to treat it. Now we start to use it and to reuse it, and it creates in a continuous, in a perpetuum way, nearly, a lot of different benefits in a fully integrated economy. And so I think in Europe, we are quite advanced in water treatment and water reuse, etc., although we still have a long way to go. There we see that we could create a lot of benefits for companies also, just by recovering the salts, by recovering some compounds and reusing them. And in a lot of cases, an installation was paid off in 2 years, just due to the fact that we recycle the water, etc. Of course, legislation is also extremely important, to have the right legislation and the right control of the legislation. It will support all the issues that I mentioned, but I think we must not wait for the legislation. We can start with the other things, because an economic benefit, everybody understands it.
Thank you. You go ahead, Vanjika. Would you like to respond or add anything else?
Perfect.
Thank you so much, Professor Ludo. I really liked what you said about taking energy out of the water and really using that. Maybe that could even be used to
I can
power the process.
We have an example operational at the moment in Hyderabad in India. It's a project which is supported by Axia Patra. It's a place where they produce, now it's reduced due to COVID, but under normal conditions, they produce 100,000 lunches for children every day. Yeah. And the wastewater, but also the waste of the production of the food, is combined into a system to produce biogas. And with this biogas, we produce energy for the place. And so in that way, you have it in an internal use system without extra need of energy coming from outside. And so we are working together with other places in the world as well to do this kind of developments. But I think it's not important only to look to what we are doing, but taking into account that energy and water must be connected in a certain way. In Europe, in the Western world, 50% of all the energy we need in wastewater treatment is used for oxidation. And so it's, and then we produce CO2,
yeah,
and nitrous oxide, two greenhouse gases. That's what we do. 2% of the greenhouse gas that are emitted are coming from wastewater treatment. We forget that because we think wastewater treatment is nice. But we have to rethink it as well. It's again, referring to what I first said about leadership, we need to make our visions a little bit new and to revise everything.
Yes, that's very, very interesting. I agree. I think it's such a great opportunity. Thank you so much. I would now like to hand it over to our next leader, Sam, who will be asking the next question.
Okay, thank you so much, Prof. Ludo. It's really awesome to hear amazing stuff that you've said in regards to water specifically, which is number one priority to life. You know, we cannot live without water. We actually need water in everything we are doing, cooking, eating, dating, just name it. And then that leads me to my next question, which is the bio-based economy. So I want to know what is the bio-based economy, and then to what extent can we integrate biomaterials in our day-to-day lives? Because you mentioned water, and I know you should also have an idea of what bio-based economy could do in our day-to-day life as well. So thank you, sir.
Thanks, Sam, for this also interesting question. I think we speak about bioeconomy and bio-based economy, and it's a little bit different. I will try to explain it. The bioeconomy is the overall use of biomass in whatever way you can imagine. That's the bioeconomy. That's the overall picture. And parts of it are the use of or the production of crops in agriculture to produce food. Yeah, that's typical agriculture. So that's part of the bioeconomy. The bio-based economy is the use of biomass in other applications than for food. It means we can use it for materials, we can use it for energy, we can use it for chemicals, for fibers, etc. That's the bio-based economy. If we use it for energy, then we speak also about bioenergy. It can be wood that we just burn, or it can also be sugar that we ferment into ethanol and that we use then as a replacement of our gasoline. And all the other uses are typical bio-based economy. So if we look in the past, we used, of course, for thousands of years, biomass as food production. So this is the basis. And we used also wood as fuel wood. So the bioenergy was also typically used. In the bio-based, of course, we know that for a long time, we used a lot of different fibers. And fibers for paper making, fibers for all kinds of other applications were used for a very long time already. And also fibers for clothing, etc. And so now we move more and more, or we dive more and more into this bio-based economy, because we developed a lot of knowledge how to ferment sugars into a lot of different molecules, how to modify chemicals that are extracted from plants and to can be transformed into other products. We learned now how to make monomers that can be polymerized into typical bio-based polymers. And these bio-based polymers can be biodegradable, etc. So this kind of developments are strongly ongoing. I would like to break a lance for the following. At the moment, we have a problem due to the fact that we bring too much fossil carbon into our atmosphere. So we need a kind of carbon sink, not just we need to take carbon out of the atmosphere. And a very nice way of doing that is by using biomass, because you know that via the photosynthesis, we take the CO2 out of it and we transform it into cellulose, sugars, you name it. So, and then we have a sink. If we burn it again, of course, then we use it in a circular way, not in a linear way. But if we use it in a material, it is really a sink, because it's a kind of storage. If you use wood to build a house, that wood is in your house for 50, maybe 100 years, and contains a lot of carbon coming from the atmosphere. So by doing so, we create a storage of carbon. And so in that way, we can decrease even the content of CO2 if we would start big afforestation projects. And so I'm personally very much in favor of these afforestation projects. And I know that Chanda Pachauri also supported strongly the Plant a Trillion Trees initiative, etc. This initiative is continuing under the heading of the United Nations. So this kind of actions are extremely important because, again, we create a lot of combinations. We create the capture of the CO2. We create more forests, which lead to increase of biodiversity. And we create the use of the wood of the forests into new materials. But I will come on to that point later on as well. So I think that in the bio-based economy, we have a huge challenge to go to the use of carbon coming from the atmosphere into our new chemicals, into our new materials. And if we do it in a smart way, we can avoid a lot of toxic elements that we have now in our fossil-based plastics, etc. So I can give you examples. We can make polycarbonate without bisphenol A. You know, bisphenol A is an endocrine disruptor, and it is possible to make now polycarbonates in a way based on lignin. Lignin is a part of the lignocellulosic part of a tree, and in that way it is possible to make materials that are much less toxic. I can give you an endless list, I think, of examples. We can make these materials much more appropriate for our health, and at the same time in a system and in an equilibrium system with our planet. Maybe as a challenge for young people concerning the big biomass approach is the fact that we need to develop better and especially milder biomass disruption methods and disruptions. So we need to do that in the future in even a smarter way, so that we need less energy, less pressure, less temperature, etc. to do that. I spoke a lot about wood. I will come back on that in the next question, I think. But it's also, of course, about all the residues of agriculture. I apologize for speaking maybe too much about India, but you know that in India, especially in Delhi, in the month of November, you have a big smog in the cities due to the fact that in some other states, like there are a lot of rice paddies that are doing the harvest, and they are burning the rice straw. And so this is about, I think, millions of tons of rice straw that are burned in the field, creating a huge air pollution problem, creating a lot of CO2 with no benefit at all for the people. Whereas we can use this rice straw as feedstock for fibers. We can transform it into sugars if we want. We can use it for a lot of different applications. And that's really the bio-based economy to do that. Maybe a last example, we are making a lot of textile out of fossil-based. We can make, as you know, viscose out of cellulose, but the viscose production process is quite an environmental bad process. It leads to a lot of environmental contamination. But now there are new methods to make a kind of textile fiber from cellulose without the use of carbon disulfide, which is a very toxic and dangerous compound. And so it's possible now to do it in a smart way and to make textile fibers that are fully bio-based for our clothing. And on top, I think it makes sense to do it in that way because we cannot increase in the world cotton production, because linking to the former question, cotton growing, the growth of cotton is consuming too much water. it's not the best plant on earth, if I can say so. So we at the moment, I think about 20% of our textile is cotton. We cannot increase that. So we have to move to other things. And then cellulose-based textile fibers are really the future. So we can really go into that direction. This is just an example. I could speak about all kinds of different applications, of course, cosmetics and so on. So it's the list is, in fact, endless. I can say that at the moment we have in Belgium and the Netherlands, we have now bio-based asphalt. So we have roads made of 20% of bio-based material, which is coming from the residues of pulp and paper making. So this is perfectly possible, and the quality is better than fossil. And that's what we need to go for. We need better quality. Otherwise, it is always difficult to convince people. So finally, I would like to say that there are companies now that can use already 94% of a tree. 94% of all the material is used to different applications. And so this is really extremely important. If we use biomass, we must avoid that we create any waste, because biomass waste, if you just put it somewhere, it will degrade and produce either CO2, either methane, which are greenhouse gases, if we cannot take them. So that's extremely important, but it's possible. And what is also interesting is that if there is so much benefit that you can take out of a tree, then the companies do not want to use any more the waste for energy, because the waste is also a feedstock for other products. It creates a benefit. So they will think about using less energy as well. Sorry for the long answer.
Thank you. That was very interesting. I would now like to hand it over to Gloria, who will be asking the next question.
Hi. So I think you touched on this a bit in your last question, but how can a combination of bioeconomy and the circular economy help us reduce stress on our planet? And how do you think that these economies can be implemented in our life?
Thank you, Gloria. And I think this is a very nice question after the first question or after the former question. I think sometimes we speak about decarbonization, but I'm not so happy with this word, because I think we use and we need carbon in our daily life. Everything is carbon that we, of course, we eat carbon, but we use carbon in our materials, in our clothes, in everything that we use. So we need carbon. If we have packaging, it's carbon. If we have plastics, it's carbon. We need it in a certain way. We need packaging, because otherwise we cannot conserve our food, etc. So it's a huge thing. But all the carbon that we use nowadays in our daily life is fossil-based. And this means that we extract a fossil feedstock from the earth and we bring it into the atmosphere as extra CO2. And that's our big problem. So that's why we speak about decarbonization. But I think we need to speak maybe in another way and to say, okay, we need carbon, but we do not want to take fossil carbon. Because fossil carbon is linear, we bring extra CO2 into the atmosphere. We can only use what we call circular carbon. And in that way, I can inform you about an initiative, which is the Circular Carbon Initiative, which was presented by the Nova Institute in Germany. And there we say we can only use three kinds of carbon. Carbon coming from the atmosphere, which is CO2. So we take the CO2 and we use it again in certain chemicals. We can use it from the technosphere, which is plastic that we have, so waste that we have, and we reuse it, we recycle it, or we can use it from the biosphere, which is the biomass carbon. And we don't use carbon from the geosphere, which is the fossil one. And so circular carbon is coming from CO2, plastics, which can still be fossil at the moment, and biomass. And that should be a kind of credo to work with for the future. Then I would like to, let me first say another thing. In construction, we use a lot of concrete. Concrete is based on cement, and we use a lot of steel. Steel and cement are two extremely difficult materials concerning CO2 emissions. So there's a lot of CO2 emissions linked to that. In a lot of cases, we can replace them by carbon-based materials as well. So we have to take that into account in a certain way as well. Let me move now to circularity. So we all understand that moving to just incineration of waste or landfilling of waste creates a lot of problems. Incineration gives CO2, landfilling gives a lot of also CO2 and methane emissions. It creates problems of leakage. It needs space, etc. So we want to move away from it. So we must bring our carbon into a circular system. If we move to circularity, even with the best technologies, we will always need some extra virgin material. The best example is paper. You know, paper can be recycled very well, but still at the end in the recycling process of paper, we need to add 10 to 20% of virgin new fibers. And it's in fact in every circular process similar. We need to add some extra in it because some residues will come out. Some residues will come out due to the fact that the fractionation system is not working perfectly, or we must very strict on the fractionation, etc. So we will have some residues that comes out, and we need some extra virgin materials. It will depend on how much percent it is, but let's say it's between 10 and 25% at least in a classical circular system. And this is a big opportunity for the bio-based economy, because this new virgin material can be provided by biomass, and at the end we replace in 20, 30 years, fully the fossil-based carbon by bio-based carbon, and then we circle it around, and we only speak about bio-based carbon, and this is, of course, carbon that is working as a sink, because it came from the atmosphere, and we took it into our circular system, whereas as long as we continue to work with fossil, it's linear carbon. It's all carbon that we put into the atmosphere. So in that way, I would like to break a lance to say that if we speak about biopolymers, mostly we only speak about biodegradable polymers, because we see the advantage if a biodegradable polymer is entering in the nature, it will be degraded and we will not have any harm of it. That's right. But I think we have more and more to speak about the recyclable biopolymers, because then we can keep them in the system and we will not go to just a circular system, but maybe an opposite linear system. So taking CO2 and bringing it in our carbon cycle. And then we create a sink, and that's the best we can do. Based on that, I would like to say that in carbon-based materials, we have two different ways. One is the long-term carbon-based, and this is all the materials that we use, for instance, in construction. Yeah, it's, as I mentioned, wood is used 50-100 years, but also it can be all kinds of paints, of resins, of plastics, of insulation, etc., that is used for a very long time. And at the moment that we stop the use, then we must go to recycling. On the other hand, we have some materials that we use in a very short period of time. For instance, food packaging. There, the recycling is much more difficult because food packaging, these plastics, are contaminated with food leftovers, etc. And so there, I think it makes sense to think about biodegradable materials, because then this can be combined, the food leftover and the material can be combined. Sorry for that. So this food and organics can be combined, and then we can do, I would say, composting, but I think it's better that we have to move away from composting, because composting again is putting CO2 in the atmosphere. But we can also do an anaerobic digestion and produce biogas, and this biogas can be used as a renewable energy source. And so in that way, I think it really makes sense. So for materials that we want to use for a short period of time, it makes sense that they are biodegradable. For materials that we use in a longer period of time, we must make them biorecyclable. And that's a little bit the difference between the two. I can continue, but I leave it here as my first answer.
Thank you so much. That was very, very interesting. Gloria, would you like to add anything?
No, I think that covered everything. Thank you.
Perfect. That was.
I'd like to say that if you have further questions later on, you can always send me an email or so, and we can discuss. I can also provide some slides to do that and so on, or we can dive into a specific topic later on as well. So it's no problem.
Thank you so much, Professor. That would be great. This is such an interesting topic, and I think it's something, well, I personally hadn't heard that much about, and all these ways where how we can use carbon in a good way and in the long term. So it'd be great to have those resources available. And finally, we have our youth leader, Mida. Oh, I think Mida lost connection. Oh, I thought she was still here with us, but she was having some trouble connecting. But she was wondering, what do you hope to see as outcomes of the COP this year?
I hope a lot, but we will see, of course. It's not so easy. But I think, of course, we were very happy with the Paris Agreement. It's extremely important. But there are, first of all, even if every country takes all the measures that were promised in the Paris Agreement, we will still have about 500 billion tons on the long term that are in excess going to the atmosphere to keep the +2 degrees. So the Paris Agreement, first of all, is not enough. That's the first. Second, I think that a lot of promises were made, but we have to see how it is moving on. And then I would like to say that it is not enough to make pledges. We have seen recently, especially last year, in fact, that Europe was the first to make the pledge that Europe would really be completely climate neutral by 2050. This was then followed by South Korea, Japan, and also countries like New Zealand, Chile, and Canada followed. Then China came with a pledge to become neutral by 2060. We hope they will bring it also to 2050, but we will see. And beginning of this year, of course, also the United States joined. So these are very nice pledges. And I think this is extremely important because this is a new phase. But I would like to see also the plans to get there. It's not enough to say we will reduce our fossil energy consumption, we will reduce our CO2 emissions by X percent. In the same time, we see that the curve is still going up. So this is really a problem. And in a lot of cases, we see that everybody make these promises, but is postponing a little bit the big actions. We are doing now small actions, few percentage changes, etc. But the big actions are for the future. And this is very dangerous. And it's also a kind of dangerous policy, if you want, because if you just say, yeah, we need to have a change, but the change will come late, at that moment, you are not responsible anymore, etc. So it's easy. So I think we need to make the change now. And so that's why in Europe, we speak about what we say, the decade of action. Every measure or every innovative technology must be developed this decade so that it is ready by 2030 and that it can be implemented and deployed from 2030 to 2050. So that's really the point. So the decade of action is now, and then the two decades of implementation will follow. And this means a lot of investment and changes, and hopefully we will really see the full transition, the transition with which I started. And so I think it's extremely important, and this brings me also to the leadership question, that countries will show big examples how they will do that, and not just saying we will reduce this and we will reduce that, but they have to show how they will do it. And we see, for instance, several countries moving on very strongly with hydrogen, but it's also still a long way to go. We see a lot of changes in renewable energy, but it's all the combination of it. It's a lot of different of different things. And maybe I also think that it's important to involve as much as possible the citizens in a certain way, because the citizens, they have an impact on policy, but also on the companies, and especially on the brand owners. And the big brands in the world, they are very sensitive for what we as consumers are saying about them. And what I see, I'm responsible for the process industry, so that's not the brand owners, but they are contacted by the brand owners asking to provide materials with a lower CO2 footprint. It's not because the brand owners like it, but because the consumers, their clients, are asking it. And so this connection is extremely important. And I think this is also a part of leadership, that we as citizens must react and ask for better or climate neutral products. And if you allow me, I can give you an example of my own university in Antwerp, where we have what we call citizen science projects. So we I will not go into detail, but we have, I think at the moment, about 10 projects where we involve sometimes children, sometimes youth, sometimes adults to participate in our science. I give you one example. We distributed small samplers for air quality measurement among the people in Belgium. So you could say, oh, I'm interested, and I will put it in the front of my house. And so thousands of people have done it. And then by analyzing these samples, we had a perfect view on the air quality in the different cities, etc. We could say these streets are very bad, these places are nice, etc. And this is not possible if you don't have thousands of people helping you as a scientist. So this is extremely important for the scientist, but also the citizens are part of the research and are part of the results. They believe in, because they are part of it, they believe it. And so they feel also responsible for it, and they ask the authorities to do something with it. And so these citizen science projects, which is a very nice issue that can be done by universities to involve university students, but also secondary school and even primary school students, is extremely important. We have a project for primary school students where they follow a tree. They must say when the tree starts to get leaves, etc. And so if you have thousands of children doing that, then you have a very nice view on how the trees are behaving in Belgium, for instance. And so in that way, we involve our citizens. And I think that's also something we should bring to COP, to involve the citizens in a way, in a positive, accountable, and responsible way to do it all together. And then authorities and companies and brand owners, etc., will follow.
Thank you. That was a really interesting answer. I really liked what you were saying about the children being able to get involved. And I think it's such an important way to really let the citizens know that they can be part of the solution, right? Yep. And not only the issues. I would now like to hand it over to Dr. Ash for any conclusions he might like to add.
I do want to convey my gratitude too and say thank you so much, because this has been one of the most enriching conversations. And Professor Ludo, I want to say thank you for offering to connect with us again. I have no doubt that we'll gain a lot more insight and knowledge as we continue to speak with you and learn from you. I think you've flagged a lot of important points, and I do want to say that you know, you have highlighted the fact that there is hope and we have lessons to learn from our experiences, and we have to be creative and also make breakthroughs in the work that we do going forward, and that the youth have an important role to play, as do all citizens. And therefore our engagement and our participation is key to you know, setting the course for a sustainable future, and also securing a healthy future for ourselves and for the planet and all species that we share the planet with. So I do wish to convey my deepest gratitude to you for your time, your invaluable insights, and also the opportunity to spend this time together with you, and hopefully lots more time. Professor Ludo, I just want to say thank you very much for the great honor and for the tribute to our chief mentor, late Dr. R. K. Pachauri. And I'd like to thank you once again. We've been so honored to have you here for the leadership conversation, climate leadership conversation series that we're hosting in his honor. And also thank you for being a precious part of our family. I also wish to take this opportunity to thank all the young leaders who are here with us, who have presented questions, who've been curious, who want to learn. And I want to say on behalf of everyone that we're so blessed and grateful to continue to learn and be inspired by you. So thank you ever so much for your time and your insights. And with that, I'll hand over to Anna to help us conclude. And thank you so much, sir, once again. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. And also from my side, I think these citizen science projects are maybe an interesting issue to further discuss within the POP movement for the future.
Thank you. Thank you ever so much, sir. And we do have a lot of young people who are doing some interesting work, which hopefully we'll have an opportunity also to share with you. And maybe we can plan a follow-up if you would agree, so as to have an opportunity for them to share more about what they're doing and also to seek your insights and guidance as they progress. I just want to say thank you for your for your direction as we make progress, but also for highlighting the role of these important projects that youth are leading. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you once again for such an interesting conversation and really such a, I think I gained so much new insights on everything that's going on and on new solutions, which I think was a great aspect of this conversation, is that it focused on the bioeconomy as a solution, right? And how we can all be part of this. So thank you so much. And I wanted to ask everyone here with us if they could turn their camera on really quickly so we could take a group picture.
Please. Thank you.
If it was available. I don't know if Priyanka and Kevin are able to turn their camera on as well. Hi, Priyanka. How are you? Okay. So let's get a picture. Ready? 1, 2, 3. Perfect. Thank you so much once again.
That's amazing.
Looking forward to a next opportunity to continue this discussion.
Absolutely, sir. And I just wanted to acknowledge that Sam just gave us a quick view. So he's actually screened your conversation to an entire group of youth in Nigeria. And could you give us a round on your camera, please, quickly? So do that again, Sam. It flipped. Oh, I think that there's a bandwidth issue, but there's, yeah.
There we go. So, okay, so I'm at a live conference and these are students for the project we are carrying out here in Nigeria. So yeah, I want to engage them on tree planting exercise. So these are all students, and then we'll go to another place very soon. So guys, say hi. Thank you.
We have to take another picture.
Yes, let's get a picture. One more, Sam. Yeah.
Okay. So, you know, I want to say for climate action now. So say that. What do you want?
Climate action.
What do you want?
What
do you want?
Okay,
so thank you very much. So I'll tell you this after.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
That is fantastic. And tell them we're so blessed to have them as part of the POP family. Thank you.
Thank you.
Has been amazing. And thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.
We're so grateful.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, family. And thank you for being family too.